Coming up on the Q30 Newscast, a dance showcase to celebrate the life of a Quinnipiac ice cat.
A new class is being added to the course catalog.
Plus, we bring you the latest in the political world and how QU students are getting involved.
All this and more coming up on the Q30 Newscast. Welcome to the Q30 Newscast. I'm Kerry Golden.
And I'm Anna Sackel. This past weekend, the Quinnipiac community celebrated and honored the life of one of its own.
Brenna Oracoli has more.
Jackie Gray was a dedicated Quinnipiac student. She was a member of the Ice Cats and the yearbook montage. Jackie had always wished that all of the Quinnipiac dance teams would come together and have a showcase. After Jackie passed away in a car accident this past summer, her former roommates decided to make her wish a reality.
Jackie's life was such an inspiration to all of us, and we just thought that this event would be such a good way to combine her love of dance in a collaborative way with all the spirit teams. Every dance number that you see is going to be to one of her favorite songs.
Dance Company. Cheerleading. Dance Fusion. Kickline. And her very own team, the Ice Cats. All came together to celebrate Jackie's true passion, dance. Burt Kahn was filled with members of Jackie's hometown dance studio, family and friends.
I just keep thinking Jackie's gonna walk through the door. She should be here. When I drove on campus, I was waiting for her to come up and see me. So this was like her home away from home already, even though it was just 1 year, and she should be here.
All proceeds from the showcase will go towards an award in Jackie's name.
We're continuing to celebrate her life and, you know, never forgetting Jax.
There's no doubt that Jackie's memory will dance on. For Q30 News, I'm Brenna Oracoli.
Up on the York Hill campus, many changes are coming their way. The York Hill CAF has added a Chobani yogurt bar after working with students to see what can be added to improve the cafeteria. There will also be ready-to-go chicken and french fries similar to the Mount Carmel campus CAF.
A new class is going to be offered on campus starting next semester. The course will focus on Black Lives Matter movement and will be taught by Media Studies Professor Philip Cunningham. Quinnipiac is one of the first schools to offer this kind of class. Cunningham gave us more information on the topics that his students will be discussing.
The course certainly isn't trying to indoctrinate anybody. It's just trying to make sure that people understand where this movement came from, how it, you know, links up with other movements in the past, why it's important. For example, for my portion, we'll be looking at sort of media responses to it in popular culture. So I just think, again, it's just about building awareness of the movement and how it came about.
You can register for the class during open registration period, which starts Monday.
A new proposal to have a student lounge on campus is in the works. John McMahon has the story.
The Student Government Association is hoping to add a student lounge to campus in the near future. The location of the lounge is still unknown to planners. The need for the lounge is questionable, especially with existing spaces such as the piazza in the student center and the dining hall. We asked students their opinions on this new space.
I think it's a great idea. There are definitely more places for students to come and work, and kids can come in groups of maybe 5 or 6, hopefully more and more places for people to go instead of just studying in the library, more places to hang out. Maybe if they install some TVs, just for more people to hang out.
Well, I think it's very interesting that they're deciding to do that. I mean, we have a lot of space as it is. Right here in the piazza, a lot of students hang out all across campus, upstairs, even in CCE. I'm concerned of where they're deciding to put it, if they're wanting to use one of the meeting rooms and change that out, or I don't exactly know where else they would put it. Otherwise, I think it might be a good idea for some students. Other than that, we'll see where it goes.
Awesome, thank you. For Q30 News, I'm John McMahon.
The Sigma Gamma Rho chapter teamed up with the men of Omega Psi Phi to host the Battle of the Sexes competition this past Tuesday. In this friendly competition, males and females went against each other in a Jeopardy-type game. The goal was to see which sex knows more about the other. The event was held in Eklund and was held to celebrate their Founders' Day.
After a long day and a dramatic presidential race, we finally have a new president. To mark the end of the election, the Student Government Association held a live viewing party of the election results. The event was held in the lower half on main campus. There was free food and a TV playing CNN's live broadcast of the election. More than 100 students showed up to the event. SGA President Joey Mullaney spoke to Q30 on why a gathering like this is so important.
We have a lot of TVs going on at different stations. Should be a good event. We're glad a lot of people showed up. Just fun, relaxing way to see who our next president is going to be.
But before the real election took place, SGA wanted to host one of their own. An email was sent out to the student body on Monday asking who they would like to be president. Hillary won that poll 46%, Trump with 42%. SGA also took this opportunity to ask more Quinnipiac-centered questions. The questions addressed issues such as parking, smoking, and housing. You can see the results of the mock election on their Facebook page, Quinnipiac SGA.
Well, speaking of elections, we now toss it over to Aya Galal to give us our political update. Aya?
Thanks, guys. Well, we have a lot to cover tonight. If there is one thing that most Americans can agree on, it's that the 2016 presidential election was both long and exhausting. Polls opened at 6 in the morning yesterday, and some Americans waited as long as 3 hours to cast their votes. As millions of Americans nervously watched the election results come in, it became clear that Donald Trump was picking up momentum. He pulled off a stunning victory and is now going to be the 45th president of the United States of America. The pundits didn't see it coming, the pollsters didn't see it coming, and most Americans didn't see it coming either. Trump clinched 279 electoral votes, and Hillary Clinton received 228. As of right now, Hillary Clinton leads the popular vote with 47.67%, and Trump has 47.50%. In addition to winning the White House, the Republicans now have control of both the Senate and the House of Representatives. There are 51 Republican senators and 47 Democrats. There will be 46 more Republicans in the House than Democrats. Trump addressed an excited crowd of supporters and gave his victory speech at the New York Hilton. He began his speech by saying Hillary Clinton called him and congratulated him on his victory. He also stated that now it's time for America to bind the wounds of division and come together. This morning, Hillary Clinton apologized to her supporters for not winning and called for a peaceful transfer of power to Trump. She said, quote, "We owe him an open mind and a chance to lead," end quote. President Obama also congratulated Trump and invited him to the White House tomorrow to discuss the handing over of power. Trump's inauguration will be held on Friday, January 20th, 2017. That's it for your politics update, and be sure to check out Q30Television.com for more updates on the election and how Quinnipiac students are reacting. I'm Aya Galal, back to you guys at the desk.
Next on the Q30 Newscast, how does the university handle student drivers on campus?
Plus, we'll bring you a national news update. We'll be right back.
I could really go for a Ray and Mike's sub right now.
Come to Ray and Mike's and try our Philly chicken and cheese for just over $4. Giant cheesesteak subs and mouth-watering boar's head sandwiches for as low as $4.75. Qcash accepted just a mile down the road on Whitney, here at Ray and Mike's.
Good evening and welcome to Sports Pause.
In the end, we're here to win a championship this year.
Jess Fontana has that. She's going to take a ripper off the post, but she's going to come back.
And my number one, hold your applause, Bobcats fans, is Quinnipiac.
All right, Victoria, you know what time it is. It's top five plays of the week.
My favorite time.
Welcome back to the Q30 Newscast.
Many students have been upset by the poor driving habits of both students and public safety on campus.
My very own co-anchor, Kerry Golden, has the story.
For many students living on the Mount Carmel campus at Quinnipiac, they spend most of their time walking from classes, residential halls, and meetings. However, when students are driving hazardously down Bobcat Way, it causes many students to feel unsafe while walking.
Yeah, at least the speed limit. Maybe even try and limit how many cars come up and down. I see a lot of people just come down to do something that they could do in South Lot.
Yes, because people are going to get hit. I actually almost got hit once, so.
This is just everyone's pedestrian here, and it's a student campus. They should be really mindful of where they're going, and it's really ridiculous. I could be running from the gym, and like I'm almost run over. It's pretty bad. There should be some kind of something there, just to warn that there are pedestrians. Just say be mindful of pedestrians, something like that, just like so they can be aware. Maybe they forget that they're driving because they're on campus, but there should be some kind of warning.
Sometimes I feel like people drive really fast down Bobcat Way, especially considering that there are speed bumps. But in general, like I feel like things are usually fine. I mean, public safety already gives out a lot of tickets as it is, and a lot of my friends actually complain about how many tickets they give out, but I don't think it would be a bad idea. I think it would actually maybe teach people to be a little more careful and be a little more conscious of the people around them.
While some students do not find it a large problem, many students do feel unsafe walking due to several instances of almost being hit or simply trying to cross the road while students and public safety are speeding on campus. Many students hope that as the year progresses, more students will become aware of their surroundings while driving. And if matters get worse, public safety will be there to step in to help. For Q30 News, I'm Kerry Golden.
Chi Omega hosted their annual philanthropy event last week, but this year they called it Swishes for Wishes. Students played basketball in the Athletic Center's Burt Kahn, as well as made donations to Make-A-Wish. The teams competed in bracket-style tournament, and at the end of the night, Alpha Chi Omega and Sigma Phi Epsilon took home the W in the tournament. In honor of Alpha Epsilon Phi's Founders Day, students were able to pie members of an AE Pi in the face. The event was called Pie a Pie and was held this week on the Bobcat lawn outside the cafeteria. The pies were not real pies. Instead, they were big plates full of shaving cream. This event was held to help raise money for AE Pi's Philanthropy Innovation Africa.
The International Business Dinner was held this past Monday in Burt Kahn Court. The dinner was hosted by Quinnipiac's International Business Society, along with students and professors from the School of Business. The dinner featured food from different cultures and around the world, as well as multicultural entertainment. The event was $5 if you registered online or $7 at the door.
On election night, while some were sitting in front of their televisions, others were, well, dancing. The Quinnipiac Dance Company held their second annual Dance Coast Sweetheart Contest yesterday in the piazza for the competition. A handful of men competed in various challenges. They were required to dance to random songs, they needed to prepare for a talent portion, and they did all of this in front of the crowd as well as answer some trivia questions. The audience then voted, and the winner was a senior, John Hurley. Hurley sang the Jasmine part in A Whole New World and nailed all the trivia according to the Dance Co members. He had many supporters in the crowd, and they said they were lucky to have him.
The annual Best Buddies Friendship Walk was this past weekend, and nearly 3,000 people came out to show their support. Best Buddies is an organization that promotes the friendship and inclusion of all people, regardless of their capability. The walk raised over $125,000 for the organization. That money will be put towards opening new Best Buddies chapters around the world and funding more events in the area.
We now hand it over to Caitlin Wardlow with your national news update.
Thanks, guys.
News comes out of Vanderbilt University this week that a former football player has been found guilty for rape. Brandon Vandenberg has been sentenced 17 years in prison for raping a classmate. The incident occurred in June of 2013 when Vandenberg carried his unconscious girlfriend into a dorm room and proceeded, with three other teammates, to sexually assault her. One of the teammates, Corey Beatty, has also been sentenced. The other two assailants have not been sentenced but are pleading not guilty in trials occurring soon. In a statement from Vandenberg, quote, "I let everyone down and many lives were destroyed," end quote. An 11-year-old girl from Ohio who survived cancer has unfortunately taken her own life. Bethany Thompson was diagnosed with brain cancer at age 3 and battled the cancer until 2008 when she was officially cured. However, the lasting effects of radiation caused permanent facial nerve damage, leaving Bethany with a crooked smile that exposed her to bullying as she grew up. This school year, the torment has been unbearable. Thompson reportedly called a friend late in October saying she could not live any longer and took her own life on October 19th. The family has recently reached out so many people can remember Bethany's positive energy and help to prevent this in the future. The United States' first female attorney general passed away on Monday after a 20-year battle with Parkinson's disease. Janet Reno served under President Clinton for both terms. She served during the convictions of the Unabomber, World Trade Center bomber, and the 1995 Oklahoma City bombing. After her attorney term ended, Ms. Reno went on to run for the governor of Florida, but lost in the primary by narrow margins. She passed away peacefully in her home, surrounded by her family. A 5.0 magnitude earthquake hit Cushing, Oklahoma this past weekend. It caused damage to buildings and resulted in evacuations. No deaths or injuries have been reported, but schools stayed closed on Monday to check for damage to the building structures. All evacuated residents were relocated to a community center that had been checked and secured for sturdiness. A similar earthquake, a 5.6 magnitude, hit earlier this month and could be felt in half a dozen states. Other than some minor damage to buildings, everything, including the pipeline systems, are okay and in sound condition. That's all for your national news. I'm Caitlin Wardlow. Back to you guys at the desk.
Next up on the Q30 Newscast, there's some fun news coming out of the entertainment world.
Plus, your full weather forecast. All this and more coming up.
This week's trending topic is hashtag that. We are your source for Quinnipiac entertainment news.
The freshmen this year have stepped in and really just eliminated that problem, doing the right plays at the right time.
I mean, it certainly seems like an uphill battle for this team, but Trisha Fabi is one of the best coaches at this university.
Bobcats hosting Arizona State. We'll start with this power play.
But she's strong. Good Lord, I saw her lifting one time. She could squat three of me.
Seven of me then.
Welcome back to the Q30 Newscast. Thanks for staying with us.
As the leaves start to change, so has the temperature.
Brooke Riley has this week's full weather forecast. Brooke?
Thanks, guys. It was a chilly day across Connecticut today, with temperatures at 48 in Waterbury and Hartford, and 54 in Meriden, New Haven, and 55 in Storrs in Norwich. But it got a little warmer over on the coast at 62 in New London. Tomorrow looks like a nice day, a good day to go out on the quad, grab lunch, or do some homework out there, with 54 and sunny, and not too much wind, west at 6 miles per hour. Tomorrow night looks a little chilly, 41 degrees, but clear, so if you're going out, make sure you grab like a little jacket. Tonight, it's gonna be chilly. Time to break out those gloves if you're heading to the library for a late night study session. 37 degrees with a lot of wind at 14 miles per hour. Now, looking at the week ahead, looks like we have a lot of sun. Tomorrow we have 54 and sunny with a low of 41. Friday, Veterans Day, looks very nice. 58 degrees, partly cloudy, with a low of 31. I know there's a lot of semi-formals this weekend, so if you're planning on taking pictures outside, go early because we set the clocks back last week, so it's getting dark a little before 5. And Saturday looks nice, a little chilly, 48, and a low of 32, but lots of sun, so it's definitely a good day to go out, hike the Giant. Sunday, a little bit warmer, lots of sun, 56, and a low of 35, so that's a good day to go out, too. The week before Thanksgiving, Monday 57, some more sun, and 38 as the low. And Tuesday looks like the only day with clouds, 58 and a low of 40. And Wednesday 59 with some sun and a low of 38. That's all I have for this week's weather forecast. I'm Brooke Riley, back to you guys at the desk.
You know, Kerry, the weather is really making me miss summer.
Yeah, but I can't wait for the sunshine tomorrow. Hey, you know about the latest internet trend, the mannequin challenge, right?
Obviously, I know about it. We were both actually in Bobcat Breakdown, which is one of our Q30 sports shows last night. Kayla Heavey is going to tell us more about the mannequin challenge and the latest Hollywood gossip.
Thanks, guys. For the past week, everyone has been watching or attempting the mannequin challenge. The goal is to gather a group of people and be as still as possible as if you're a mannequin. Many videos have been seen and set to the song Black Beatles. Everyone from high schools, sports teams, and even celebrities have been trying this new popular trend. Next up, singer Lorde took to Facebook with a long post to explain how she's been feeling and to make a big announcement that will excite all Lorde fans. She started out with saying how much she loves being a teenager and feels getting older, although her teen years came to an end this past Monday when she turned 20. According to the post, she prepared herself for adulthood by moving out of her home into the city and tried to discover who she was. Then the big news came. She wrote an album based on this transition and will be releasing it soon. Lorde explains it won't be coming out next month, but soon, and she's excited to share it with all of her fans. In other more political-themed news, Lady Gaga has been one of many who has been criticizing Melania Trump after she gave a speech about bullying online. The pop singer tweeted at Melania Trump, claiming her husband Donald Trump is one of the most public online bullies. Gaga doesn't take cyberbullying lightly. Her and her mother have created a nonprofit organization called Born This Way Foundation. Its goal is to raise awareness and put a stop to cyberbullying. Lady Gaga isn't the only one that's reacted negatively to the speech. However, she explains that one of her goals as First Lady would be to campaign against cyberbullying. And finally, Carrie Underwood made an appearance on The Tyler Oakley Show recently. While playing a questionnaire game with the host, she revealed some important information you may not have seen coming. She met her husband, a Canadian ice hockey player, Mike Fisher, at one of her meet-and-greet events. 2 years after they met, they got married, and now the happy couple are parents to the 2-year-old son. While on the show, she also admitted to having a celebrity crush on Chris Pine, but it's just a crush, and she said she never would want to meet him in person. That's all I have for entertainment news. Back to Carrie and Anna at the desk.
Next on the Q30 Newscast, MJ Baird will update us on the men's soccer team and women's rugby.
Stay with us.
I could really go for a Ray and Mike sub right now.
Come to Ray and Mike's and try our Philly chicken and cheese for just over $4. Giant cheesesteak subs and mouth-watering boar's head sandwiches for as low as $4.75. Qcash accepted just a mile down the road on Whitney, here at Ray and Mike's.
Thank you. Good evening and welcome to Sports Pause.
In the end, that we're here to win a championship this year.
Jess Fontaine now has that. She's going to take a river off the post, but she's going to come back.
And my number one, hold your applause, Bobcats fans, is Quinnipiac.
All right, Victoria, you know what time it is. It's top five plays of the week.
My favorite time.
Welcome back.
I know we have a big weekend coming up for Quinnipiac sports, but a lot has been going on in the past week.
That's right. The regular season is over for some sports, but we may have some champions here at QU.
We now send it over to MJ Baer to give us our sports update. MJ?
Ladies, thank you. November, the second to last month of every single year, and with it comes fall sports playoffs. A number of Quinnipiac sports teams made the postseason this year, so let's jump right to the action. Becky Carlson and her defending champion rugby team will begin the NIRA playoffs this upcoming weekend. The Bobcats are the higher seed, but will travel to Pennsylvania to take on Westchester due to the field renovations. Quinnipiac defeated Westchester twice last season, including once in the postseason. Over on the pitch now, the Quinnipiac men's soccer team clinched the MAC regular season title on Wednesday in its win over Fairfield. Ryan Scheiderman tallied the game's lone goal off a free kick in the first half. After the game, Scheiderman told me, quote, "This isn't the end for us," end quote. The win marks the third conference championship in four seasons for Eric DaCosta and company. With winning the conference games comes hosting the postseason tournament, which will take place this weekend. Quinnipiac will play Canisius in the semifinals on Friday, and Ryder will play Siena. The two winners will move on to the conference championship on Sunday. Senior captain James Doig is expected to make his return on Friday after missing almost 4 weeks due to a right arm injury. As for the women, they too played in the MAC postseason tournament. The Bobcats traveled to West Long Branch, New Jersey to the host site, Monmouth University. The semifinals took place on Friday, with Quinnipiac facing off against conference foe Siena, whom they had never beat going into the game. In upset fashion, the Bobcats defeated the Saints thanks to a second half goal by sophomore Al Pelletier following a Quinnipiac free kick. The goal signified the only one of the contest for both sides as the Bobcats held on to win the game 1-0. The win earned the Bobcats a spot in the conference championship for the first time in program history and a chance to take down the top-seeded and host team, Monmouth. Let's take a look at how they did. As I said before, we are in West Long Branch, New Jersey. The Bobcats and the Hawks, of course, this game being played on the Hawks' home turf as they were the top seed in the conference. We'll take you to the first half now. Take a look at this one. Take a good look at it. Allie DeLuca, have a rip from way outside the 18-yard box there. That puts Monmouth up 1-0. Olivia Myshevsky, no chance there for the Bobcats. Great shot from DeLuca. Still in the first half, though, we're going to have a cross from the... Wait, that's not a cross. A little outside of the foot action there. That comes from Rachel Ivanicki from Monmouth. I thought that one was a cross, but no, she puts that one right in the back of the net. And look, just about the same play a couple minutes later. This time, though, Miranda Constantinides gets her head on the ball in the box for a traditional header. That makes it 3-0 Hawks, though. Bobcats frustration clearly setting in. Madison Borowick gets a yellow card there, kind of drops the shoulder into the Monmouth player. We're not playing rugby, we're playing soccer, though. Let's go to the second half now. Things change a little bit. Nadia Gill, she gets taken down in the box. Sir, that's going to be a penalty kick. Quinnipiac elects for Kelly Caruso to take the PK. Give her a dustpan and a brush. She cleans that one up. 3-1. Quinnipiac thinking maybe there's a chance, but no. Monmouth just too much for the Bobcats. Maddie Gibson puts this one in. Olivia Myshevsky tries to come out and play the ball, but to no avail. Final score, 5-2 Monmouth. The Hawks, your 2016 Metro Atlantic Athletic Conference champions. The second time in 4 years for the Hawks. Four straight regular season titles for the Hawks. Kerry, Anna, that's all I got for sports. Back to you.
That's all we have for you tonight. Be sure to follow us on Twitter at Q30 News.
And check out our website at Q30television.com.
I'm Kerry Golden.
And I'm Anna Sackel.
Good night.
Good night, Quinnipiac.